Hello everybody, this is Spiffy Guy. We are back on the trail again on a beautiful day. Supposed to get up to 65, so it's a day that makes you definitely think that spring has sprung. We are at Lost Valley Trail. We were looking for some geocaches on the western loop of the trail. Should be about 5 miles or so. We'll see how quickly we can get through this. It's 10 o'clock right now, so see if we can't do the short loop in about 2.5 hours. Well, this whole area is part of Weldon Spring Conservation Area. There's hunting out here, and this is all part of the area that was used for making munitions and later nuclear material during the 40s. And it's all been, you know, purchased back by the conservation area, and it was cleaned up, supposedly. But maybe we'll find some three-eyed frogs or something along those manners. Very neat tree. So we left the trail. The trail is down that way somewhere. And we went off to find this geocache. We did not find it. Based on the logs, though, I could see is the coordinates are off. So it explains why I couldn't find it. So we're on to another one that's a little off the bush, or off the trail in the bush. Some rocks. I'm guessing maybe down by there. The terrain, though, is pretty steep, so it's definitely a good hike. This little draw here. We're definitely not going to get the whole 5 miles done as we continue to screw around out here in the woods. But it's certainly a beautiful day. The wind is blowing, which is nice because it's keeping me a little cool. Draw here, and we are headed somewhere. My GPS is a bit funky. I wonder if it's on the fritz. It's telling me that we need to go. Oh, I just lost satellite reception. Huh. Somewhere up there is a satellite. Well, let's figure out where we're going. I won't get back to you. So here's a good example of why you don't trust technology. Because my little old GPS here kept losing satellite signal. It kept telling me I was a mile away from where my location was. And then it would change and then keep losing signal. And there's not really a cloud in the sky, a tree cover. And so here I am quite literally standing on the side of a big hill, wondering which direction to go. Oh my. Map doesn't lose batteries, doesn't lose reception. Lesson learned. as the GPS calculates how far I am from my geocache. I don't know if that's picking up or not. But now it says I'm 0.1 miles away from my geocache. Oh, there we go. Satellite reception lost. It's constantly doing this. I'm going to swap the batteries out and see if that'll fix it. Well, it seems to be tracking a little bit better. I switched the batteries. They weren't low. So I'm not sure what the deal was, but moral, always carry spare. Well, we found the cache in right here. Ammo can. This is despite the GPS saying it's another 25 feet up the hill. So I think the reception in this valley is pretty bad, and the coordinates might be slightly off. So we'll sign the log and we'll keep on rolling. All right, now that we found that one, we are, the wind is blowing, these trees keeps cracking. I look around for deer or something walking through the woods. Anyway, we're gonna head up the big hill. There's another one up there, about a half mile. So we are pretty much off the trail, that's for sure. I know that the trail is back down this way, down that draw. There's a creek down there. I believe it's called the Little Femme Osage Creek, and the trail's on the other side of that. So I need to keep my bearings about me. Even though I got the GPS, as we've seen so far, there is issues. You could lose satellite, the batteries could die. There's a multitude of problems, so you kind of need to know where you're at. I know that the sun is off in that direction, and that is the direction of my car. It's about a little after 11, so obviously the sun is moving to the right. But I know that if I continue that way, which is south, I will hit a highway. So if I ever did get lost, I could go hit the highway and then walk to the east there, and I would find my car. Of course, I have my compass with me. I don't have a map, though. I didn't print one before I came, which is, I guess, a mistake on my part. But I thought I was going to be on the trails the whole time. So prepare, you never know what's happening. Now we head up the hill. Well, we found the geocache back in that big pile of down trees there. And it was a bit of bushwhacking, but worth it. We came around here and found this lake. Just kind of sitting here. I didn't see it on the GPS map, so I didn't even know it was here. And there was a couple ducks. They heard me coming through the undergrowth, and they ran off. It's pretty windy out, though. But it's pretty neat. There's a red-tailed hawk up there riding the wind. It's a gorgeous day. He's got a blind over there. Check that out. And then we're going to head back and see if we can't find the trail and maybe a couple more geocaches along the way. Knife. Doesn't look very good. We'll dispose of that. Well, it's not a blind, it's some sort of sewer runoff. It goes down, there's some water and a pipe down there. not that exciting. All right, we're gonna head over that direction. Well, this is a survey marker. It's a little yellow sign here that says there's a marker here. It says 7404M34, Missouri Department of Conservation Engineering Section. So it's kind of neat to find one of those out here. There's a sign telling about it. Another marker back there on the tree. Yeah, might mark a waypoint. Might be something fun to find later on. Here's another good example of a shagbark hickory. You know, all up this trunk. You have lots of bark just sloughing off. That's a good indicator in the winter that it's a shagbark without leaves, because you know, you can see right here there's some hickory nuts on the ground, but there's a lot of mixture of oak leaves, different types of oak, and I'm not sure you'd be able to tell the leaves on the ground with wind and things blowing around, so that bark is a really good indicator. I found this path when I was going to the last geocache, so I came back to hop on it and see where it goes. And it's definitely a trail. I didn't find it on any of the maps of the area or anything. So, I figure it's heading back the direction of the car. And that's kind of the direction I want to go. And it certainly beats going down into the valley and bushwhacking and falling down hills. So I'll just follow this and see where it goes. Alright, hopefully you can hear me over the wind noise. Trying to shade the mic a little bit, but this is where the trail came out. It's right at this old parking lot. I have no clue what this parking lot was for. It's got handicap placards on it. We'll take a closer look, but there's a little pond here, and right down on the other side of this little mound is a trail that connects up with the main trail right kind of where near the main parking lot is. It actually worked out rather well. Trail over there. Over there is the main trail where I started. So here's this little pond here. And we're gonna go over to this parking lot and maybe cook up some lunch. I found a little bit nicer place to have lunch than just the parking lot. Some creek here. Cars are just down that direction. But anyway, this is what we're gonna try out. This is a Red Bull chimney stove. It's a Red Bull can. And it's pretty windy out here, as you can see. It's just a Red Bull can opened up from the middle. So the bottom is sealed, actually the top, use that as the bottom, and this is the bottom, just cut out the size of a quarter, shove it in there, punch some holes around the edge, there you go. I'm going to use it in my little super cat kind of stove caddy just to get it up off the ground a little bit, because this cone is made specifically for the super cat. A little bit here, sorry. This cone is made specifically for the super cat. So the pot has to lie on the actual top of the super cat, whereas with the chimney stove, it does not. So I will take some measurements of this stove and make up a new clone for that. And we've got 2 cups of water, 16 ounces, and we're gonna put in about 15 milliliters of fluid and see if we can't boil up that 2 cups. I tried 10 milliliters and I got a total of an 8 minute burn time on it. So I figure 15, we'll definitely make sure that we boil. It's gonna boil it a little slower than the super cat, but it should work. So, try out. Well, after 10 minutes, the little Red Bull stove had some bubbles in the bottom, but it didn't bring it to a boil. So I wasn't able to actually cook my lunch, which wouldn't be good in my opinion. So I guess that kind of brings, you know, the question as to whether configuration of the Supercat using, you know, 20 milliliters of fluid to bring 2 cups of water to a boil in about 4 to 5 minutes, whether that's a better option. That I'm not sure. So what I'll have to do is I'll have to do a little bit of experiment at home in a controlled environment and see how that works. But the clone itself is working real well as a windscreen. It rolls up rather nicely. My spoon will light my fire. Titanium fits inside there, and then I put the whole thing, wrap it up in a used Tyvek mail pouch. And you know, I got something in the mail. I'm gonna stick this in there, roll it up, and it works out well. So there's that. Back to the drawing board, you know, which is why we test stuff. I think if I was to go out for a trip, I would take the Supercat over the Red Bull. So another option is to see how it works with the Trangia. The nice thing about the Trangia stove is, you know, you just put the fuel in there, you don't have to measure it out. When you're done, you snuff it, and the fuel stays in there. So that's another good option to, you know, to take. It weighs a little bit more, but maybe it's more fuel efficient in the long run. I'm not sure. So got to do some tests and figure it all out. That's why we do what we do. And anyway, thanks for watching. I'm gonna head to the car and head on home and cook some lunch there and head off to work. So y'all enjoy.